She felt humbled to the dust. Could not the adventure of the chest have taught her wisdom? A corner of it, catching her eye as she lay, seemed to rise up in judgment against her. Nothing could now be clearer than the absurdity of her recent fancies. To suppose that the manuscript of many generations back could have remained undiscovered in a room such as that, so modern, so habitable, or that she should be the first to possess the skill of unlocking a cabinet, the key of which was open to all. How could she have so imposed on herself? Heaven forbid that Henry Tinley should ever know her folly. And it was in a great measure his own doing, for had not the cabinet appeared so exactly to agree with his description of her adventures, she should never have felt the smallest curiosity about it. This was the only comfort that occurred. Impatient to get rid of those hateful evidences of her folly, those detestable papers then scattered over the bed, she rose directly, and folding them up as nearly as possible in the same shape as before, returned them to the same spot within the cabinet, with a very hearty wish that no untoward accident might ever bring them forward again, to disgrace her even with herself. Why the locks should have been so difficult to open, however, was still something remarkable, for she could now manage them with perfect ease. In this there was surely something mysterious, and she indulged in the flattering suggestion for half a minute, till the possibility of the doors having been at first unlocked, and of being herself its fastener, darted into her head, and cost her another blush. She got away as soon as she could from a room in which her conduct produced such unpleasant reflections, and found her way with all speed to the breakfast parlour, as it had been pointed out to her by Miss Tinley the evening before. Henry was alone in it, and his immediate hope of her having been undisturbed by the tempest, with an arch reference to the character of the building they inhabited, was rather distressing. For the world would she not have her weakness suspected, and yet, unequal to an absolute falsehood, was constrained to acknowledge that the wind had kept her awake a little. "But we have a charming morning after it," she added, desiring to get rid of the subject. "And storms and sleeplessness are nothing when they are over. What beautiful hyacinths! I have just learned to love a hyacinth." "And how might you learn? By accident or argument?" "Your sister taught me. I cannot tell how. Mrs. Allen used to take pains, year after year, to make me like them. But I never could, till I saw them the other day in Milsom Street. I am naturally indifferent about flowers. But now you love a hyacinth, so much the better. You have gained a new source of enjoyment, and it is well to have as many holds upon happiness as possible. Besides, a taste for flowers is always desirable in your sex, as a means of getting you out of doors and tempting you to more frequent exercise than you would otherwise take. And though the love of a hyacinth may be rather domestic, who can tell the sentiment once raised, but you may in time come to love a rose. But I do not want any such pursuit to get me out of doors. The pleasure of walking and breathing fresh air is enough for me, and in fine weather I am out more than half my time. Mama says I am never within." When Catherine Morland gets the chance to accompany a neighbouring family on an extended visit to Bath, it opens up a world of adventure and romance, unavailable to the naive 17-year-old in her Wiltshire village home. She is soon captivated by a feeble clergyman Henry Tilney, befriends flighty Isabella Thorpe, and also attracts the attention of Isabella's disagreeable braggart brother, John. The latter tries to drive a wedge between Catherine and Henry, while Isabella introduces her to Gothic novels, with their lurid plotlines. Catherine is invited to Northanger Abbey, the Tilneys' family home, which seems to come straight from the pages of one of these potboilers. Her imagination in overdrive, she speculates that Henry's widower father harbours a dark secret over the fate of his long-dead wife, and in doing so threatens the blossoming relationship.